When we go out to eat, we never agree on where to go.
I want burgers!
Pizza!
Tacos it is.
The one thing we do agree on is we all want unlimited high-speed data. That's why we switched to MetroPCS.
Stop by MetroPCS with the whole family and get four lines with unlimited LTE data for just $100, period. MetroPCS. Wireless. Figure it out.
Coverage not available in some areas. Offers require port and a number not currently active on T-Mobile network. During congestion, the fraction of customers using more than 35 gigs per month may notice reduced speeds. Video streams up to 40p. No tethering. See store for details and terms and conditions.
Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome to Nonprofit U, a forum where nonprofit stakeholders can share lessons learned and discuss the latest developments in the industry. My name is Valerie Leonard, your host. I'm a consultant to nonprofits, and I specialize in community and organizational development. I work with nonprofit organizations to help them make a stronger impact to their clients and communities. You can find Nonprofit U on Facebook and Twitter, and I encourage you to follow us and to comment early and often using the hashtags NonprofitU or SustainabilityMeetsSocialJustice. You can also leave comments on the blogtalkradio.com/nonprofit_you. The chat room is open, and you can post comments and questions. In order to use the chat room, you must open a listener-only account. You will find a link to open the account on the page for this episode. And you can also email me questions at consulting@valeriefleonard.com. Taking questions by phone and from our chat room at about the 20-minute mark or so. And the call-in number is 347-884-8121. Again, that number is 347-884-8121. Today's topic is where sustainability meets social justice. We'll talk about the work Blacks in Green has done to create a 5-year green village building proof concept in a TIF in Chicago's West Woodlawn community. They've also had a role in negotiations surrounding a community benefits agreement between the Englewood community and Norfolk Southern Railroad and the 8 principles of green village building. Again, we encourage you to call in with questions at about the 20-minute mark. You can start posting in the chat room and emailing your questions now. Again, my email address is consulting@valeriefleonard.com. If you want to participate in the live chat, you must open an account, and the link is found on the episode's page. Call-in number again is 347-884-8121. Hello? Valerie Leonard, I am so sorry we had technical difficulty, and I am waiting for Naomi to give us a call. Naomi is the founder of Blacks in Green. I have not yet been able to connect with her. In the event that we don't hear from her, we will probably talk about another topic, and I will give her a few minutes to call. But in the meantime, if you have questions, you can give us a call at 347-884-8121 and ask questions about Blacks in Green, environmental justice, as well as economic development. Again, that call-in number is 347-884-8121. While we're waiting for Naomi, I just wanted to take some time and share with you a recap of a discussion that I had with the folks from Blocks Together. They did a recent launch of their TIF toolkit, and they are in the process now of developing a participatory TIF process where the community actually takes part in deciding, you know, how the TIF money is spent. I had a chance to go to their TIF launch, and they asked me to give a talk on gentrification versus revitalization. So I just wanted to share that with you. I'm not sure that we'll hear back from Naomi. We may end up having to reschedule of revitalization. And then we will talk about the definition of gentrification, the difference between revitalization and gentrification, as well as the definition of equitable development as policy links would describe it. And then we'll talk about some of the tools to combat gentrification. So when we talk about community revitalization, we're really talking about bringing new life to a community by improving existing assets, and at the same time, we want to honor the existing history and culture without displacing residents. And so doing, careful attention is also paid to increasing the capacity of the local residents to take control of their own environment. So it's the people who are currently living there who are driving the process. So under gentrification, the process of neighborhood change results in displacement of the lower income residents with higher income residents. And it completely ignores the history and culture of the existing community, and it completely changes the character of the community by creating new names, new narratives. You might get zoning changes to increase density of buildings and all that good stuff. So the communities that are most vulnerable to gentrification are obviously low-income communities. They have high concentrations of subsidized housing. They're typically located near the downtown area or some other hot community that might have high housing costs. They might have low property values and low land values, which makes it very attractive to speculators. They have low levels of home ownership. And, you know, as homeowners, you typically have a greater voice and more control over what happens to the land. And they also have high numbers of properties in disrepair or building code violations. So this creates a very ripe environment for a takeover. And one of the things that hurts these communities the most is they're typically disorganized and they have low levels of civic engagement. So there's no community voice to. In a nutshell, the difference between a gentrifying community and a revitalized community. A gentrifying community will see new affluent residents who focus on, quote unquote, reinvesting resources for greater returns. You'll see them rehabbing houses, for example. Gentrifying neighborhoods also will see a demographic shift as the property values rise, and you'll see wealthier white residents replacing poorer minority residents. And on the other hand, revitalizing neighborhoods, they are going to take a more community-oriented approach, and then they're going to focus on economic, you know, they'll have economic and demographic shifts, but they will not be as stark, and it'll feel more organic. And those neighborhoods will also see more new businesses instead of just new homeowners. Policy Link, they focus on equity in development, and their definition for equitable development is an approach to creating healthy, vibrant communities of opportunity. Equitable outcomes come about when smart, intentional strategies are put in place to ensure that everyone can participate in and benefit from decisions that shape their neighborhoods and regions. So there are a number of tools that you can use to minimize the effects of gentrification. You know, there's no one size fits all. And in fact, you can't really use but one tool. You have to use several tools at the same time because gentrification usually results in several forces coming at communities at from different directions. So you're going to have to use multiple strategies. And it's virtually impossible to stop market forces that drive gentrification. So the best you can hope for is to minimize the effects and try to negotiate the environment so that it is favorable to people who already live there. So some of the most effective strategies will involve litigation. And on the zoning and land use side, you want to make sure that housing developments include provisions for low to moderate income families. You know, for example, 25% set aside for low-income families that are already in the neighborhood. You want to also fight zoning changes that significantly increase density. You know, because, again, you don't want to change the character of your neighborhood. And a number of these neighborhoods are older neighborhoods. They're historically significant. They're architecturally significant. And you don't, you know, if you want to preserve that, you really don't want to increase density. And then you want to make sure, too, that you fight the adverse impact of removing affordable housing units on minorities. So if you see that there's a consistent adverse, you know, disparate adverse impact, you want to make sure that you have an attorney who can demonstrate, you know, that there is a pattern of low-income people being impacted and removed and fight that. You also want to look at the environmental impact of the development on the neighborhoods. In some states, you can actually look at displacement of minority residents as part of the environmental impact. And then you want to also look at building code enforcement and do it in such a way that as there are building code violations and these properties may be taken from landlords, try to figure out a way that if the residents of those properties can't purchase, there's some community organization or church or some developer that has an affinity for the current resident, you know, make sure they can own it. And then you want to fight eminent domain abuse. And eminent domain abuse is usually when you have a private developer who has a relationship with City Hall, and they can make the case, or you know, they will advance the case and say that it's more advantageous for the community to have some pet project that they're pushing than it is to keep current development as is. In other instances, they may have a stated development, but then try to take more land than is what's required for that development that they're sharing. And then there may be other instances where they might want to rezone the property and there's no necessity to rezone the property. You also want to make sure that there's local governance and decision-making. And one of the favorite ways, you know, is TIF advisory councils. That's one of my favorite ways. It's not very well, it's not used widely, even though Chicago is probably about 60% TIF. Aldermen tend to want to control those TIF dollars themselves with as little community input as possible. Another decision-making tool is resident-led community associations and then resident-led planning councils. You want to make sure that there is as much decision-making going on with citizens, you know, sharing the power with the elected officials as possible. People who live in communities are not as likely to make decisions that are not in their own best interest. You also want to make sure that you have a pretty strong economic development plan. And some of the tools you can include in that plan are community-controlled credit unions. They would be most likely, you know, since they're taking investments from the locals, they'll probably be more likely to use the money to lend to folks to buy cars, lend to folks to buy houses, lend to folks to start their own businesses. You would want to include small business development strategies, obviously, and then create a local chamber of commerce who can then, you know, navigate some of the government systems and then advocate on behalf of the community, you know, for more jobs, creation of business, and all that good stuff. Another strategy is through workforce development. You want to make sure that local residents can increase their earning potential and wealth. Typically, when you have a low-income community, the workforce is relatively low-skill, has low educational levels, and or they if they are not low-skilled, they may have skills in areas that are in mature industries. So some of your strategies would obviously include making sure that as these new businesses come, you retool the residents to prepare them for the new jobs that are coming so they can be competitive. And then when we look at housing, obviously you want to maintain affordable housing, and we should be careful about how we define affordable housing. You want housing that is affordable to people who are still in the community. You want to increase people's potential to buy and keep their houses through first-time home buyers program. And then another strategy is community land trust, where a community organization would purchase land, they would build houses, and then they would sell the houses. But, you know, they would retain ownership of the land. And as the house is bought and sold, it doesn't include the price of the land, and it keeps it, you know, relatively affordable to the people who are buying the houses. You can't beat tenant organizing as a strategy, and for this housing where you have co-ops, you know, where people are purchasing the shares in the property. So that is basically, in a nutshell, what my talk was about. I would be really interested to hear what some of your thoughts might be in terms of strategies to help mitigate the effects of gentrification and some of your experiences. You know, I can tell you some of the experiences I've had in North Lawndale. We were getting the Ogden Pulaski TIF, and you know, I want to make it clear, I'm not anti-TIF, but I am very pro-equity, very pro-community. But you know, there were opportunities where that TIF, as it was developed, could have served the community a little bit better. So there were instances where we, the folks in the community, we read the redevelopment agreement from our perspectives. You know, if we were business owners, we read it from a business owner's perspective. If we were homeowners, we read it from a homeowner's perspective, and we looked at pros and cons and how this could work for us, you know, to our advantage, and how it could potentially harm us. And one of the things that we found, you know, when looking at the redevelopment plan, you know, it called for the development of 300 new units of housing, some new open space, and then the equivalent commercial space of a dual do that. The plan called for the acquisition of about 1,600 units of land, abandoned property. It could be vacant land or blank land, vacant land. So we thought that in this case that was a bit much. So we did advocate, and we got them to reduce the number of properties that they were going to acquire from 1,600 some odd until about 660 properties. Another issue that we had with that plan was, you know, there seemed to have been a pattern where they were going to rezone residential properties from Cermak to Ogden along Ketzi, and that would have displaced residents. When they looked at the dilapidated properties, you know, we went and did an inspection, you know, ourselves as citizens, and we found that many of those properties that were listed as dilapidated were recently renovated, and there was some political stuff going on where the former alderman had included the then current alderman's house under the dilapidated property. So, you know, TIF should be taken seriously and not used for political gain and all that good stuff. So at the end of the day, you know, through our advocacy, we actually got to the point where the number of properties that could have been displaced was reduced from about 1,200 to about 52. So a significant reduction in the potential impact. We did recommend that they do TIF Advisory Council. You know, that was back 2016. To this day, we do not have TIF Advisory Councils. We do not have any participatory process as it relates to TIFs or as it relates to our budget. So, you know, there's still work to be done there. So I'm going to stop right there and open it up again for questions. If you have any questions, my number is area code 347-884-8121. Again, that number is 347-884-8121. So if you have any questions, feel free to call in. Okay, and then again, you know, like I said, you know, when we look at gentrification, another tool could potentially be used is the community benefits agreement. If you're in Chicago, that's not very common, but you want to look at a community benefits agreement whereby new developers, when they come in, you know, they have access to a number of incentives that could, you know, get them tens of millions of dollars. And you're not necessarily, you know, you're not trying to shake them down, but they're using the census tracts of the low-income communities to get economic gain. And in many cases, the gains that they get as a result of developing in an impoverished community don't revert back to the impoverished community. So you want to enter into a community benefits agreement whereby the community is held responsible for certain things as well as the developer. So you want the developer to provide things like jobs, and ideally you want the community who are very well qualified who can fill those jobs. Also, you know, once you come to a meeting of the minds, you as a community member, you know, who is part of that negotiation, should be at a point where you're no longer fighting the developer. You have come to an agreement where you believe that there's win-wins on both sides. You know, the developer can get economic benefit, but the community can share in terms of jobs and other opportunities. And the benefits don't always have to be monetary. You know, you want to be creative and think of ways where the community can benefit as a whole and not just one or two people, you know, getting everything that they can. Okay, so we've come to the end of our show, and I'd like to thank you so much for being patient and listening in. I'm sorry we had technical difficulty and we had a glitch. I know Naomi had every called in, but, you know, apparently there was a technical problem on her end as well. So we will be able to hear from Naomi another time. And I want to also let you know that we will be here next week. Mark Lane will be, I guess. And Mark Lane is the Vice Chairman of the Cook County Commission on Social Innovation. And we will talk about ways that innovation can drive economic development at the community level. So until then, I want to say thank you so much for listening, and I am looking forward to talking to you next week. Take care.
When we go out to eat, we never agree on where to go.
I want burgers!
Pizza!
Tacos it is.
The one thing we do agree on is we all want unlimited high-speed data. That's why we switched to MetroPCS.
Stop by MetroPCS with the whole family and get four lines with unlimited LTE data for just $100, period. MetroPCS. Wireless. Figured out.
Coverage not available in some areas. Offers require porting of number not currently active on T-Mobile network. During congestion, the fraction of customers using more than 35 gigs per month may notice reduced speeds. Video streams at up to 480p. No tethering. See store for details and terms and conditions.